Hi, welcome to Watch It Played. My name is Rodney Smith, and in this video, we're going to learn the 2-4 player game, Near and Far, designed by Ryan Lockett and published by Red Raven Games. Somewhere, far off, lies the last ruin, a city fabled to contain an artifact that will grant its finder their greatest desire. You and your opponents have head off in search of it across foreign lands, where you'll encounter colorful characters, strange creatures, and go on unexpected adventures. So join me at the table, and let's learn how to play. To set up, you'll first pick one of the 4 game modes. And no matter which one you choose, Near and Far is played out of this atlas, with each game taking place on its own 2-page spread. Within these, you'll find locations to visit with specific story adventures that you'll encounter within this separate book, forcing you to make crucial decisions affecting the outcome of your experience. One mode to play is the campaign. This has you play through 10 maps, with each game taking place on one map after the other, landing you at the final destination of the last ruin. In this mode, you'll have your own unique character that you'll customize as you play. There is also a character mode as well that doesn't require you to play through all of the maps. However, from the storybook, you'll be provided with specific quests and stories related to your particular character while retaining the ability to customize that character as it goes on its adventures. Arcade mode allows you to play a single map and uses a deck of cards rather than the storybook. And this can be useful if you feel you've fully exhausted the many stories found here and still want to keep the game fresh. And finally, we have the first adventure mode, which introduces the main rules of the game using the very first map of the book, the Glogos Caverns. The rules for this mode are the basis for all other modes of play, so we're going to learn the first adventure in this video. In a separate video, which I'll put a link to in the description of this one, I'll go over all of the rules for the other modes of play if you'd like to check those out. But for now, let's go back to the table and set up this first adventure. These are the quest tokens, and you'll use a certain number of them based on the number of players. I'm going to set up a 2-player game, which uses 7 tokens, 3 players would use 10, and 4 use 13. On the map, you'll find a variety of these circle spaces, but some of them have an open storybook icon above them. Place your quest tokens on a random assortment of these storybook icons, spreading them across the map. In particular, try to ensure that you have some quests near this specially marked town space and others that are much farther away from it. These are the threat cards, which you should stack in order based on the value shown here, with the highest number on the bottom all the way up to the lowest number on top. You then place this deck in the space found for it on the atlas. Above the atlas, place this double-sided board with this dusk side face up. These are the treasure cards, which you'll shuffle into a face-down deck and place into the Mystic's Hut. Also find these double-sided tokens that have a pack bird on one side and a turtle on the other. Put 3 per player, bird side up, into the stable space here. Now find these animal companion tokens and set them aside from the rest of the adventurer tokens, which you'll gather up and shuffle into this included bag. From here, draw 5 adventurers, placing them face up in the spaces found here at the top of the board. These are double-sided because all of them can be used in a separate prequel game called Above and Below, which we also have a video for, and I'll put a link to in the description of this one. That game plays quite differently and is not required in order to play this one, but these characters can be used in both. For Near and Far, the side showing a bed in the corner is always ignored. Nearby, place this deck of world cards face up, which don't need to be shuffled, along with the food, coin, faction, and gem tokens. The game also comes with actual plastic gems that you can use instead of the cardboard ones. These 4 chief cards should also be laid out, along with the dice. Each player now takes one of the player boards, an aid, and a heart token, which they'll put on the 0 space of this track. They then collect 3 coins from the supply and place them on the pictured pack here. Along the bottom, you'll notice 2 rows of tents. Collect 10 pieces in the color of your choosing and then place 1 on each space until they are all covered. You'll have some left over, which you can then return to the box for now. Find the animal companions that you set aside earlier and have each player take one of these dog-cat tokens. Any extras along with this special platypus, can be returned to the box, as we'll learn about it in the next video. It doesn't matter whether you use the cat or the dog side, but whichever you choose, place it into any one of these four spaces. Now collect one of these unique character standees to represent you, and find the matching reputation token, which you'll place onto this zero space of the reputation track. If you have a two-player game, pick any unused character standee and put it into this town hall building. The rest of the unused characters can be returned to the box. Then, choose a random player and give them this first player token. These are the artifact cards which you'll separate and shuffle separately into two face-down piles based on the designs you find on their back. This is the basic, and this is the advanced deck. Now you'll deal 2 advanced and 5 basic to each player who will be able to examine them privately. From the 5 basic cards, each player will choose one to keep, placing it face down in front of themselves. And once each player has done this, they'll pass the remaining 4 cards to the player on their left. They'll then examine those, pick another one to keep, and again, pass the cards to the left. And you'll keep going back and forth like this until both players have a total of 5 basic cards face down in front of themselves again. During this process, you can always examine all of your cards at any time. Just ensure you keep separate the ones that you've already chosen from those you're still passing back and forth. Now each player must discard one of their advanced cards. Then they may discard any number of the other cards remaining in their hand, which could include their other advanced card. Perhaps I will discard these two here. We'll see later why you may wish to remove or hang on to some of these artifacts, but discarded ones go into their own shared face-up discard piles, which can be examined at any time. And that's the setup. In Near and Far, you'll do things like recruit new adventurers to your party, stock up on supplies, trade goods, and head out on adventures, all in an effort to gain the most journey points by the end of the game. The game is played over a series of turns, starting with the first player and then going clockwise around and around the table. And on your turn, you'll perform one of 2 possible actions. You'll either visit the town or head out on an adventure. But for each player's first turn of the game, they must visit town. So let's learn that action first. One of the spaces on the atlas shows this symbol representing the main town, which we have an expanded view of here. This board and the buildings pictured on it represent the various places that you can go when using the visit town action for your turn. Simply pick a single building, move your character there, and perform its action. You can stay in town several turns in a row, but on each new turn, you must always move to a different building than the last one that you were on. So if I was in the mines, then on my next turn, I could go to any other building other than the mines, and then on my next turn, I'd have to go anywhere other than the general store, so I could go back to the mines or to one of these other buildings. So now, let's learn what these various buildings do. If you go to the farm, then you'll gain a food token from the supply for each skill symbol found on the members of your active party. These are the tokens in these 4 spaces on your player board. You'll also gain food for any skill symbols found on artifacts that you've purchased. These are ones that would be face up in front of you, not still in your hand, as well as treasure cards that you've obtained. And we'll see how you get both of these things a little bit later. At the beginning of the game, however, you'll only have your pet, which has a single skill symbol. So by going here, I would gain a single food token. If I did have all 3 of these skill symbols, then I would gain these 3 food tokens, or you could take a single one with a value of 3. Either way, take whatever you're owed from the supply, and again, add it to your pack. But I should mention, gems, coins, faction, and food tokens are not limited by what's included in the game. If you would ever run out of what you need from the supply, use a suitable replacement for any that you're owed. If you go to the saloon, you'll be able to recruit a single new adventurer to your party from those here. Simply pay from your pack the cost in coins as shown in the adventurer's bottom right-hand corner that you'd like to obtain. So if I wanted this one here, I'd have to spend 1 coin from my pack, returning it to the supply, and then I could take this token. Newly recruited adventurers may be added directly to your active party. Each of these spaces show one of the 4 possible banners in the game, representing the Outlaw, Lizardfolk, Nomad, and Mystic factions. And these may only hold 1 adventurer from that faction type. So this adventurer, which is showing the Mystic faction, would have to go into this space. However, if I later recruit another Mystic, I can either put it into this position by replacing the old adventurer, moving it here to the side of my board where it becomes inactive, or I could have kept it in place and the new recruit would instead go directly to the inactive area. Outside of recruiting a new character, you may only rearrange the members of your active party when you're leaving town. Also, the animal companion that you start the game with has no faction banner, so it can be placed in any empty space. If you later gain a new member for the color it is currently covering, you can either move it to a new empty space in order to make room, or simply move it to your inactive party. I should point out, when buying new adventurers, you pay one less coin for every faction banner you already own that matches the faction banner of the adventurer you're trying to acquire. And these can be on any adventurers you already bought, whether in your active party or not, or on these faction tokens that you might have. So if it was later in the game and I wanted to buy this adventurer with the blue faction token, which would normally cost me 4 gold, I only have to pay 1 because I have 2 blue mystic characters already, as well as this faction token. However, faction banners that might be on any artifacts that you have face up in front of you never apply to this discount. You might remember during the setup we put out these 4 chiefs, and as soon as any player possesses 4 of the same faction banner, again, on anything other than the face up artifact cards in front of them, they claim the chief sharing that symbol. At the end of the game, this will be worth a number of journey points as shown in the upper left-hand corner. Once you have a chief, no one can take it from you, even if you later possess fewer than its 4 faction symbols. The chief also counts as a single banner of its faction, which again discounts a coin from adventurers you would purchase that match its color. Before or after gaining an adventurer at the saloon, a player taking this action, as shown here at the bottom, may spend 1 food from their pack, returning it to the supply, in order to discard all of the adventures currently in the saloon. They then reach into the bag and draw out 5 new ones to refill this row. If they had not already bought an adventurer that turn, then they may pay for and recruit one as normal. Either way, anytime you gain a new adventurer from this row, draw a new one from the bag to refill the row to 5 tokens. If this bag would ever empty, then place all of the discarded adventurers back into it, give it a good shuffle, and then draw any new ones as required. If you go to the stables for your town action, you may pay a single food from your pack back to the supply in order to take a single pack bird. The gain token is then placed on this leftmost space of your player board. And at most, you can have 3 pack birds, as the spaces indicate. We'll discuss the value of these a little bit later. If you go to the Mystic's Hut for your town action and have at least 1 pack bird, draw a single card from this deck and add it to any empty treasure space under one of your pack bird tokens. This means you cannot have more treasures than the number of pack birds you've already purchased. If you don't have an empty space under a pack bird, for example, maybe we left this action space and then came back here later to do it again, drawing a new treasure, this spot is already filled. So after examining the new card, you can choose to either replace the card that's here by sending this to a discard pile, or you can discard the new one that you just drew if you'd prefer to keep the older one. If an effect would ever resolve to let you gain a treasure, but you have no pack birds at all, ignore that benefit and draw nothing. If you go to the general store, you may either gain 1 coin from the supply or draw any combination of 4 cards from the artifact decks. Just declare how many of each you want before drawing and then take them. For example, I might say I want 1 advanced and then 3 basic. After drawing these new cards, you can then examine them and choose any number of them to discard. So maybe I decide to get rid of these. You'll put them in the appropriate discard pile and add the rest to your hand. Again, we'll learn more about the purpose of these a little bit later. This is the mine, which has 12 numbered spaces for digging. To dig a particular number, you must have at least as many skill symbols in your active party and or on purchased treasure and artifact cards. If no spots have been dug yet, a player must always dig this underlined number first, meaning they need at least 1 skill symbol. This player currently has 3 skill symbols, which is more than enough. So they now take their next unused camp from their player board and place it over top of this number. Your camps are in two rows, and you always start by taking them from this position and then going across the top row and then from left to right on the bottom row. So I would take this camp and then place it here. If the camp you take from your board exposes a symbol, then collect that type of resource from the supply and add it to your pack. Instead of a coin, sometimes you might find a gem symbol, in which case you'll add a gem to your pack. When you place a camp on a mine space, you then gain the reward shown above and to the left of it. In this case, there is no symbol above it, but we would get the coin as pictured here. Any player who wants to dig next must then choose a number above, below, or to the left or right of a camp already in the mine. So as an example, a player could not dig here or here, at least not yet, but they could go here if they had a skill of 1, or here if they had a skill of 2. In this case, they would gain a gem as well as a coin. The final building in town is the town hall itself, and there are 3 different actions you can perform here. And you can choose to do any or all of them, and in any order you want, once per visit. This is the trade option, which lets you trade any combination of up to 5 goods to obtain any single good. Or you can trade a single good for up to 5 goods of any combination, assuming the total value of any goods paid is greater than or equal to the value of the goods gained. Was that confusing? Well, don't worry, we're gonna clear it up right now with an example. Each good's value is shown here on the left. So if I wanted a blue faction token which has a value of 7, I could trade up to 5 different goods to get it. Maybe I return to the supply from my pack this green faction token which has a value of 4, and 2 coins which have a value of 2 each, for a total of 8. Now this is worth more than the blue faction token I'm trying to gain, and I won't get change back, but I can now add this token to my pack. Now you can't do more than 1 trade like this per trip to the town hall, but just as another example, I could have likewise sold a single good like this yellow faction token, which has a value of 6, in order to gain up to 5 other goods of equal or lesser total value. So if I did choose to trade this in, I might take from the supply 2 food, a coin, and a gem. Now, although that was only 4 items, and I can technically take up to 5, together they equaled the value of the single good I paid, so I can't take any more. Another action here is to discard 1 artifact from your hand to the appropriate discard pile. At the end of the game, any artifacts you still have in hand will subtract 1 from your final score. So if you have something that you can't or don't think you want to complete, this is the only way to get rid of it. Finally, we have this option to spend any combination of coins and or gems to gain or lose 1 reputation for each spent. Your reputation is shown by the position of your marker on this track. You increase your reputation by moving your token to the right or decrease it by moving to the left, but your marker can never go above 12 or below -6. So if I spent these 2 gems and this 1 coin for a total of 3, I could increase my reputation, moving it here, or decrease my reputation and place my marker here. Everything I've told you so far about taking actions within the town assumes that when you go to a building, there's no characters there. However, if you want to go to a building that does have a character, before you can take any action, you must duel them first. We set up for a 2-player game, but you might have more. If you go to a location and there's more than 1 opponent there, you still only have to duel 1 of them. But either way, you now simply declare aloud who your target is and whether you intend to fight honorably or dirty. Now both players will roll a single die, and the attacker, that is, the person whose turn it is, will add 1 to that value if they fought dirty. Both players now add to this total the number of these sword symbols showing on the adventurers in their active party, as well as on bought artifacts, treasures, and world cards that they might own. Finally, the attacker, and only the attacker, may spend any number of these hearts that they have left over, adding 1 point to their total for each. Keep in mind, at the start of the game, you'll have no hearts, but we'll see later how you might gain some to spend. Now the player with the highest total wins, and the defender wins in the case of a tie. If the active player, that is, the attacker, wins, They gain one reputation if they fought honorably, or lose one reputation if they fought dirty. They then perform the action of the building where the duel takes place, but nothing happens to the defending player's standee. If the active player lost, they move their standee directly to this jail spot, and their reputation is not adjusted. However, they forfeit their action for this turn. And once again, nothing happens to the defender. If a player starts their turn in jail, then as usual, they can either go adventuring or visit in the town. But they can go to any building, even if it's occupied, and they don't have to perform a duel. The opponents take pity on the ex-con for that one turn. Do note the saloon is the one building in town that you can always go to and you never have to duel. There's plenty of room for everyone, as shown by the symbols here. That said, if you want to duel a player that's already there, you can choose to. Also note that in a two-player game, an unused character is always in the town hall. And if you would go there and both your real opponent and this character are there, then you must duel your opponent. But if this non-playing character is here alone, then you'll duel it instead, with your opponent rolling the dice for it, but never adding any swords. And those are all of the building actions. But as we said earlier, on your turn, you can instead choose to take the adventure action. And that's actually made up of two parts. First, you leave town. And then after that, you can move. Now, if you start your turn and you're already outside of town, you're somewhere on this map, then when you adventure, you don't leave town again. You've already left. But you can continue to travel further or return back to town. So let's go to the table and I'll show you exactly how this works. If you start your turn in town and decide to go adventuring as your action, you first get to freely rearrange the members of your active party, swapping them with members that are inactive. But remember, at most you can have one of each faction type in the different slots of your party. Now total the values found within the heart symbols of your active party members and add to that any hearts on treasures or artifacts that you might own. This marker is then moved to that total value on the track here. So in this case, we had a total of 9. But keep in mind, you may never exceed 13. Also, if you had leftover hearts from a previous adventure, do not add them to this new total. So when leaving town, if we had already had 3 hearts, we wouldn't then get 12, we'd still only get 9. Now place your character standee on the town space of the map, which shows this symbol and acts as a reminder to reset your hearts when you leave town. However, if you later walk away from town and then back over this space, you do not reset your hearts. Only when you're taking the leave town step of an adventure action does this happen. If you just left town, or if you started your turn already having left town previously, you may now move. Your total movement is the number of these arrows that you have, and as you see here, players always have a base movement of 2. But this can be boosted by other things. For example, each pack bird you have adds another arrow, and sometimes you might have treasures that provide them, or even members in your party that will also contribute additional arrows. But in this case, we have a total of 4. Each movement point allows you to travel from the space you're currently in to any other space that's connected by one of these dashed lines. When moving, you can stop at any time. You don't have to spend all of your movement. And you can even go back and forth across the same dashed lines multiple times within the same move. However, at any point during your movement that you pass over an empty space, you must spend one of your hearts. An empty space is one that does not have a camp token in it, no matter what color. Let's pretend for a moment that there was already some camp tokens on the map. If I now moved like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, I only passed over one empty space, so I would only spend one of my hearts. To pay hearts, just move this marker backwards the appropriate number of spaces. The exception to this empty space rule is the town itself. It never costs a heart to move over it. So going 1, 2, 3, I only moved over this empty space, so I would only spend one heart. I wouldn't spend anything for this one. We'll learn more about camps a little later, but I should mention that any number of players may share the same space. It should be noted, you never pay hearts for either an empty space that you start your turn on and leave from, or an empty space that you end your movement on, because in both of those situations, you are not considered to have moved across those spots. So just to be clear, if I started my movement here and went only to this space, then I would not pay any hearts, even though both of those spaces are empty. But I actually do want to move on because I have some other examples to show you. So if I went here, then I would pay a heart for this empty space. And then let's say I want to continue to this space. You'll notice in the middle we have a symbol, and this represents a threat. Before you would try to cross over one, make sure, again, you pay any hearts for empty spaces that you passed over, and then put your marker here. This threat is represented by the top card of this deck, and its difficulty level is the number listed here, so in this case, a 4. The moving player now rolls a die and adds to it the sum of all sword symbols found on characters in their active party, as well as on treasure, artifact, and world cards that they might have in play. If the total value is less than the difficulty of the threat, the player may choose to spend any number of hearts that they have in order to match it, adding 1 point for each heart spent. If the player can't or chooses not to create a total high enough, then they must run from the threat, returning to the previous space they moved from, and their turn immediately ends. They also don't gain back any hearts they spent trying to move across this space if it was empty. On the other hand, as we have here, if their total equals or exceeds the threat, they take its card and slide it under the top of their board like this. They then take their next camp token and place it on the symbol found here, again claiming any benefits from symbols received, in this case, nothing. At the end of the game, defeated threats will earn you the journey points shown here. And after a threat is defeated, you must move your character to the next space in the direction that you were traveling. You may never end your turn on a threat symbol itself. Now we said earlier, you can move back and forth across the same dashed path, and that means you can also move back and forth across the same threat multiple times during your turn. Just be sure to pay any heart costs for the movement, and fight the next threat in the stack each time, and you can see they each get progressively more difficult. Instead of fighting a threat, you can bypass it in one of three different ways. If you have a pack bird, you can sacrifice it to ignore a threat, discarding any treasure cards that it might have been storing. However, you may still use any movement point that it was providing you with for the remainder of this turn. Keep in mind, pack birds, when discarded, are returned to the supply in the stables where they can be bought later. Instead of discarding a pack bird, you can ignore a threat when moving across it. If any member of your active party has this shield symbol, or if one of these are on a treasure card, or an artifact, or world card that you have in play. As long as you have at least one shield symbol, you can bypass any number of threat symbols that you would move across during a turn. Finally, if you have an active artifact, treasure, or world card that allows a player to ignore threats, the player may follow any included instructions there to do so. Although we haven't yet discussed how camps get added to the map, I just want to point out that as soon as two of any color are on the spaces directly on either side of a threat, then that threat is no longer active, and players must ignore it when moving across that path. However, if there's only a camp on one side of a threat, then that threat is still active and must be fought. Instead of threats, you might pass over one of these treasure symbols, and when this happens, you draw a treasure card as long as you have at least one pack bird. Then you either add it to a valid empty space on your player board, discard it, or replace one that you currently have. Like threats, you may pass over the same treasure symbol multiple times on your turn, ensuring that you pay any heart cost for empty spaces that you're moving over. And also like threats, treasures become inactive as soon as there are two camp tokens on either side of that path. For this next example, I've turned to a different map in the Atlas to explain that whether dealing with a threat or treasure symbol, you can assume that the town space always has a camp on it for the purposes of determining whether or not the symbol is active. So in this case, the threat here is inactive because there's a camp on this side, and although camps are never built in town, you always assume that they just have one. After a player has finished their movement, if there's a quest token there, they may choose to attempt the quest by discarding that token and announcing the letter or number found printed above that space. The person to the left of the current player now picks up this storybook and flips to the section that matches the map you're playing. In this case, the Glogos Caverns. They then go to the letter or number that was announced. I'm sure for some of you, you'll get a lot of enjoyment from discovering these different passages for yourself, so I'll make sure that I don't spoil any more than is necessary to teach you what you need to know. If you're the storybook reader, you now narrate aloud the passage of text directly below the appropriate section. You will then present the current player with options as indicated by the bolded text here, which you will also read aloud. However, do not read this additional narrative text or these rewards. Instead, the current player must now make a choice between the options presented. In this case, the player could choose to fight the villagers to free the boy, which would require them to obtain a combat value of at least 6, or they would need to meet a skill level of 5 if they choose to convince the townsfolk to let the boy go as a step towards peace. Once they've made their choice, they roll a single die, and if it was a skill challenge, they add any skill symbols they have in their active party and on cards they have in play. And if it was a combat challenge, they add any swords they have in their active party and again, in play in front of them. In either case, they can also spend any number of hearts they have in order to boost that value even higher. If the player's final value is less than the required skill or combat value, according to their previous choice, then nothing more is read and the quest just ends. However, if their total is equal to or higher than the required skill or combat, the player succeeds and the reader narrates the appropriate section. So if our player chose and succeeded in the combat option, then this passage would be read. And the narrator concludes by announcing the reward as listed here, which the active player then collects. Each and every quest in this book also provides a bonus reward, which the player will gain if their total value was at least 2 points higher than necessary. So in this example, if the player had a combat value of at least 8, in addition to the normal reward, they would also gain a bonus coin. If a quest would adjust your reputation as part of its reward, you must always move your token accordingly on the reputation track. You can't choose to forego the change. Some rewards will tell you to gain a particular card. In this case, we're told to gain the adorable kitten. And that's something you'll find in this world deck. Just go through until you find the card you need, take it, and put it face up in front of you. Also, if a reward tells you to gain a particular colored faction, in this case we're told to gain a yellow faction, that means you just take one of those tokens from the supply and add it to your pack. The beginning of this storybook provides some additional guidelines in following the requirements for any special encounters you might have. So if you see something unfamiliar while narrating a passage of text, just refer to this section to clarify any questions that you might have. After a player finishes their movement, and whether or not they attempted a quest, they may then build a camp if the space they are on doesn't already have one. And this is important because each space at most can have a single camp. To build the camp, the player must spend 3 hearts. Then they take the next camp from their board and place it into that space. If the space shows either a coin or a gem, then you take as many of that item as the number of search symbols found within their active party and on cards that they have in play. Search symbols look like these little eyeballs. So in this case, we have 3 of them. We built the camp on a space that shows a coin symbol, so we would gain 3 coins, adding them to our pack. To help you remember some of these costs, on your player board, you'll find this guide that tells you you pay 1 heart for every empty space you move over and 3 hearts when you want to build a camp. There's also an included card which goes over the different symbols that you'll find in the game, like the search one, and explains what they do. Some spaces show these trade route symbols instead, and there'll be 2 of each of them on each map. If you build a camp on any of these, you gain no coins or gems. However, if you build one of your camps on each of 2 identical symbols, then at the end of the game, you control the trade route and you earn the larger value as shown here. If you and another player both have a camp on a pair of symbols, then you share the route and you get the smaller value instead. However, no points are gained from a particular route if only one of its spaces have a camp on it. So just to recap, on your turn, you're either taking an action at a building in town or you're out adventuring. And just to be clear, you can always immediately return to town to go to a building as your action, no matter how far away from town you might actually be on the map. So the blue player, for example, could move directly to here on their turn and take an action at the general store. When returning to town like this, retain any hearts that you might still have because you might want to spend them during a duel. Also remember that if you leave from town, you'll always go back to this space. It doesn't matter where you came back to town from. At any point during your turn, you may buy an artifact card, which is known as a free action. You do this by paying the cost of one that you're holding in your hand. This cost is shown along the left side of the artifact you're trying to purchase, so in this case we'd have to spend 1 gem from our supply and have a reputation of -1 or lower. If a cost requires a positive reputation, then it's satisfied if you have that much or more. Once purchased, an artifact is placed face up in front of you and will provide the ability as shown here. Also, at the end of the game, it'll be worth this many journey points. Just be aware that any symbols shown on the cost of the artifact don't count for anything. For example, the faction symbol here does not count towards gaining chiefs or coin discounts when recruiting. Also remember that at the end of the game, artifact cards still in hand will subtract 1 point each from your score. Speaking of which, the game end is triggered when one player has placed their 14th camp. You then play until everyone has had an equal number of turns. In other words, the player to the first player's right will have the last turn. If any player still has camps they need to place during these final actions and they've run out, they can use the extras in the game box or any suitable replacement. But now it's time to add up the final scores. First, you gain journey points for each camp you placed. And if you placed your final camp, you get 2 more points as shown here. If you have 3 treasure cards, which would look something like this, then you gain 5 points as indicated here. Now add your trade points. Remember, for each of these symbols, where you've claimed both spaces, you'll gain this larger amount. And where you share the route with another player, you'll each gain this amount. Every artifact you purchased will now give you journey points as shown in their upper left-hand corner. So add those together and then subtract 1 point for every artifact you still have in your hand that you did not purchase. Also, some treasures, artifacts, and world cards will provide further bonus points as written on their effects. This artifact says the player gains 1 journey point for each nomad they've recruited. Well, they have one here and here, so that's a bonus of 2 more points. Any threats you defeated will now provide you with points, as shown here, and then you take points equal to how many coins and gems you have, dividing by 2 and rounding down. So here we have a total of 5, and that would give me 2 points. You also gain a point for each unused faction token you have, so here I would gain 3 more points. Food tokens provide you with nothing, and then you claim 5 more points for each chief that you have. Finally, on the reputation track, gain a number of points based on the point total you're either on or most recently passed. So if I was here, I would gain 2 points, or if I was here, I would gain 3. Total all these journey points up and the player with the highest value wins. In a tie, the player with the highest reputation wins, unless there's a player with a tie-breaking card effect in their possession. However, if still tied, the player with the most total coins and gems wins. And if there's still a tie, then the tied players share the victory. And that's everything you need to know to play the first adventure. And really, this is 90% of all of the rules, including for the other modes of play, which we'll cover in a separate video that I'll put a link to in the description of this one. But if you have any questions at all about anything that you saw here, don't hesitate to put them in the comments below, and I'll gladly answer them as soon as I get a chance. But until the next episode, thanks for watching.